defunding the police happening right in front of you. Family gets $12 million after their father died in police custody. Here's the clip.
The video starts with police arriving on the scene after Prude's brother called them, saying Prude was experiencing a mental health episode. The footage shows an officer approach Prude, who was on the street naked.
Get on the ground. Put your hands behind your back. Behind your back. Yes, don't, move. Yes. Don't move. Don't move. Chill out, man. Don't move, all right, man? Yes, just don't move.
Yes, sir.
Prude complies with the officer's request and is then handcuffed.
Jesus Christ, I pray, man. Let me go, man. Give me the handcuffs, bro.
Then, 3 minutes after the initial encounter, officers place a spit sock over Prude's head to minimize exposure after they say he was spitting. It distresses Prude further.
Yo, get the away from baby.
And when he does not comply and appears to try to stand, three officers get on the ground to physically restrain him and hold him to the ground.
I'm already in. Drag and kill me.
One officer has his knee on Prude's back and the other is holding his head to the pavement while the spit sock remains on his head.
Another officer can be seen putting his weight on Prude's head, who appears to be struggling to breathe.
Mr. Prude is dead. Put up his picture. He should be alive today. City of Rochester has now agreed to pay an eight-figure settlement to the children of a black man who died while in police custody. Daniel Prude's family, after months of mediation, arrived at a mutually acceptable number. Two federal judges approved a settlement of $12 million minus attorney fees and costs to go to their children, to go to the children of this male who should be alive. Mr. Daniel Prude. A grand jury opted not to level criminal charges against the officers involved, citing with their claim that they were following department training when they engaged Prude. I believe the grand jury got that part completely wrong. Let me give you background to the family and their legal pursuit to get a semblance of justice here. And believe me, they'd rather have this young black male alive than the money. Originally, Prude's sister filed the civil suit, but a judge later ruled they were the estate's rightful heirs. Of the settlement, $6 million is allotted for conscious pain and suffering compensation, with the other $6 million being compensation for monetary damages for the wrongful death of their father. The city did not pay any punitive damages to the children, who will only receive $8 million after paying the lawyers. They should have received punitive. Punitive is meant to be a punishment because of your actions. They received no punitive damage here. Months after the incident, the family was finally able to see the video as it was released to the masses. The video was met with scores of protest and resulted in the firing of the police chief and the departure of senior command. Chief Leron Singletary tried to resign but was terminated before the resignation went into effect. Rochester Mayor Malik D. Evans, who was not in office when Prude was killed, released a statement saying the settlement was the best decision for the city. Remember, it is a record settlement. Let's put up his picture. Leron Singletary, who currently is running for Congress, drew criticism when the Prude family pointed to a series of emails from June 2020 between city officials and the police commanders coordinating the time of release of the body cam videos of the circumstances around Prude's death to the family and to the public. The police argued that with national fervor around Black Lives Matter, there might be blowback to their department because of the death of a black male. Efforts to prevent this from happening again, Prude's son, Nathaniel McFarland, said in a statement, his father was not a criminal and that his only crime was needing help. Now, with the help of their lawyers, they are asking for the New York legislature to pass Daniel's law. Daniel's law would arrange for trained mental health professionals to respond to the mental health crisis in communities instead of police officers. I concur with that sentiment. We've been saying the same thing right here. Day one on Indisputable. There are places they can look at for case studies. Ithaca, New York. We had the mayor of Ithaca, New York right here on the show telling us about how they developed their response based on actual 911 calls they surveyed. It comes to this conclusion. 50% of the 911 calls did not even require a police officer. Look at the data. Let your decisions be data driven like Ithaca, New York. Invest in your community, which includes those that may experience a mental health crisis. This man should be alive today. Rickey, thoughts here?
Sometimes, Dr. Richey, I think they want to have training for mental health, because I think some of them are trigger happy, like Marvin Gaye saying song was going on trigger happy police. Because see, with that, you have mental health calls in place. Now you can't pull the trigger. You have to hold them down until somebody can get there and subdue them and make sure that they don't have no medical issue. And now, and to me, in my opinion, I think sometimes they use lack of training. We're not trained for mental health in order to justify killing somebody. And it's just pretty much another George Floyd situation.
Well said. We're going to stay on top of this story.